Now we'll move on to Poulad, and he will talk about WAPOR-based performance indicators.
Hello. Hi. Thank you, Lauren, and thank you, Marius, for providing such a good introduction. It makes my life very easy because I can always go back to what you describe in details. So basically, one of the uses that we can have for the WAPOR database is actually to use them to do what we call performance assessments using performance indicators. Why do we use this indicator? Is generally about when we have an irrigation system, we would like to improve system operations. We would like to maybe know how far are we from our strategic goals. I mean, at the beginning, we have some goals, but then throughout the years, we have to see whether we have been able to achieve those goals or are we drifting away from the where we started. We could also use this to assist our management. I mean, as a day-to-day operation of the irrigation scheme, we can use these kind of indicators and performance assessment to guide those. We can also use that to kind of look into the general health of a system. And also, when we do intervention, before doing so, we can also see that whether what are the impacts of those interventions. It can also be used for other uses, especially what we call benchmarking. Benchmarking is a practice through which we compare a system with other systems. Imagine you have 10 irrigation schemes. You want to know where your irrigation scheme A stands in comparison with the other 9. Or how irrigation system A compares with its own performance over the years ago. So that is a practice in irrigation engineering or in irrigation management we call benchmarking. The overall goal of doing all these is to actually improve productivity of the use of land and water, and also make sure that the quality of service delivery of irrigation is there. So these are why we do these sort of indicator-based operations and indicator-based corrections. However, there are challenges. I mean, everybody likes to have all this information, but in reality, there are a lot of resources needed to collect this extensive data. Those resources include time, labor, and also budget. There's also an issue of the lack of continuity. We can do one irrigation performance once, and then the next one maybe in 10 years, if the irrigation scheme actually has enough funding and enough resources to carry on that. Also, we don't have, we have limited knowledge of the past. We know a bit about it today through performance assessment, but we don't know how was the scheme 5 years ago. So we cannot really understand how the system has changed. And also, what we do in physically doing it, it would be limited for a small geographical extent, basically for an irrigation scheme, or if you have a large budget for a district or a province at most. But what WAPOR has to offer here is that it offers freely available data on land and water and climate. So speaking to one of the issues that was about the budget and then the time that it needs to collect that data. WAPOR offers continuous data. Data comes at decadal and then for seasonal, annual, and then you can continuously keep monitoring the situation. It can provide a glimpse of the past. The data goes back to 2009. So we would have 10 years of data that to build upon. And also it covers a large geographical extent. It covers continental scale analysis. So these are what WAPOR would have to offer us to carry on irrigation performance assessment in a new way. The way it works is that you have WAPOR data, you have the land use land cover map coming from the same database, you can use your irrigation system boundary to extract information that you need for performance indicators. Those details will be explained by Dick to some extent today, and then of course continued by a detailed training in the week after, by Abedo, which actually goes through all these steps of how we extract this information. What I want to show is a couple of indicators that are some of the indicators that we can quickly do and then use for this kind of analysis. These include water consumption. We look at it from through evapotranspiration, crop area, yield, reference evapotranspiration, beneficial fraction, equity, relative water deficit, relative yield reduction, and water productivity. These are some of the indicators that we can quickly calculate with using WAPOR. And if you want to, we want to show this with the case study in Bekaa Valley in Lebanon. The first and most important to us as agrohydrologists are evapotranspiration. It helps us to track water consumption. That can be done through space and through time. The graph to the left shows seasonal ETA or actual evapotranspiration variation for winter wheat in Bekaa Valley. You see the numbers are changing. So you don't have a continued or continuous number that is repeated every year. So that helps you to understand how evapotranspiration actual has changed over the years. You can also look into this from a spatial point of view. So you can pick up a year, pick up a season, pick up an average of a couple of years to see how spatially water consumption through evapotranspiration has changed. These are a lot of important information because you would know which part of your scheme is actually consuming more water or which part of your scheme has not received enough water to be able to do to provide the crops with the required water. So that information you can benchmark and you can understand through this through tracking of evapotranspiration. Another indicator is crop area. It helps us to track the extent of the land with the use of land. So you would know in any particular season or year how many hectares of land has been under cultivation for major crops. I mean, at the moment, this crop map is provided by WAPOR at 30 meter resolution for selected areas. But some of the time, at times we can have that information also coming in from the secondary sources that we can use to support our analysis. Again, that can be looked upon as the interannual changes or between seasons to see how it has changed. And if you look into the graph, you see how it is dynamic. I mean, say in 2013 and 14, the area under cultivation of winter wheat in Bekaa Valley has about 5,700 hectares, whereas the year before is about 2,500. This shows how dynamic some of the decisions are. And then as irrigation engineers, as planners, as managers, we really need to know about these things. We really need to know whether the area is increased, where area is decreased, why they are happening, and then what are the reasons behind that. And hopefully that would help us to guide our intervention to improve the situation. The other important indicator is the yield. I mean, yield is the ultimate information that a farmer requires because that speaks directly to how much livelihood they can make out of a hectare of land. So, and tracking yield is important because it also is one of the SDGs, like we want to increase the double crop production, and then that has to happen hand in hand with increase of the yield and the land productivity. So when we actually look into the yield, again, you see a lot of variation. So it's not that the yield is constant. An area could be going through different yield, different years. And then when we do this kind of analysis, you would understand what we could take in a step towards understanding what are the reasons behind this. Also, especially looking at the spatial distribution of yield also gives us an idea of what are the areas or spots that produce more yield and which are the areas that produce less yield. Then we can go ahead and then look into the reasons why some areas lag behind and then how can we help them to improve. ET reference is another important indicator because it also tells us the guide us through water allocations. Because crop water demand traditionally has been decided using crop coefficients times the ET reference. So in that case, when we actually make those decisions, it would be good for us to see how the reference evapotranspiration has changed over time and how is that correlates with the change of evapotranspiration actual in the same area. Another important indicator is beneficial fraction. It tracks the system's efficiency in turning water consumption into benefits because it looks into the transpiration part of the ET as opposed to evaporation. Per definition, evaporation happens from soil surface and transpiration through plant. Hence, only transpiration contributes to biomass production, which is our beneficial use. So through this doing and then tracking beneficial fraction, we understand how efficient is our system towards translating water use to biomass production, which gives us direct benefits. We could also look into equity. Equity is a very important indicator. It tells us how fair is water distribution. how equitable has been our plans and operation of irrigation towards making sure that all the farmers have access to water with the amount that they need. If you see, this graph shows how equity has changed over time in Beka Valley in the, for irrigated winter wheat. And you see, I mean, the area in red is the area that is rather critical. You don't want to go there. These decisions are where the critical point starts. It's rather arbitrary. You have to take on, I mean, you can consider your local situation, local target, or you can look into the general literature. Generally, we say something between below 10 is the target, between 10 to 20 or 17, or that range is the reality and acceptable. But anything past that is a critical point that we would like to have improved. We could also look into relative water deficit, which tracks the irrigation water adequacy. It shows us how much of water in comparison with the maximum evapotranspiration has available through each through different space at different places in an irrigation scheme. Here you see again the changes of the relative water deficit through years. You see in some years the water there has been a huge deficit in water. In other years there have been less deficit. And you can also look into this spatially and see what are the areas that are more affected by the lack of availability of water. You could also go back to calculating the yield reduction. I mean, this is, I'm glad that Pasquale is also joining us here in this webinar. This work comes from his publication of FAO 66, where the simple equation has been introduced to relate relative water deficit to relative yield reduction. And if you look into the graph to the right, you see how a linear relationship can be made between the relative yield reduction and relative water deficit. And KY is actually our crop yield factor. And then if you compare that, we have for Beka Valley through this practice 1.06. And interestingly enough, the number that has been suggested as a global, like kind of average in FAO 66 is 1.05, which shows how this, some of these empirical relationships are actually quite accurate, and how can they be used to represent, to be used to understand how yield reduction may happen because of water deficit. These kind of relationship can be used easily. Say, if we know that next year we have 20% water reduction than what we need, what would be really our yield reduction? Very important factors for our planning and for decision making when it comes to allocation and deciding how much deficit may have to be given in different sectors. And last but not least is the water productivity, and that tracks productivity of use of water. And you see, I mean, generally it changes through years. In Beka Valley, we see a general increasing trend in water productivity that from 2009 to 2019. So, and then also you can see how especially this distribution is within the Beka Valley in Lebanon. To help us to understand where we should focus and then where are the good spots and what we learn from them and what kind of things or intervention can be used to improve the spots that are having lower water productivity. In summary, WAPOR offers free, continuous, and data that covers a very large geographical area and starts in 2009. This data can be used to track irrigation performance, both spatially and temporally, through years, through seasons, and show us where the locations are for the hot spot and bright spot. And also, that information of the irrigation performance assessment can be used for benchmarking and planning actions for improvement. There are sources that I've used in this presentation, all open source, ENI and FAO publication. You can just click on the blue links and then get all the documents to kind of give you a little bit more insight into the theory that is behind these indicators. Thank you so much.